Hi there, and you're welcome to another informative and educative episode of AAU Talks, the voice of higher education in Africa. My name is Agyemang Okyere Darko. You know, we're in a quest of achieving the Africa we want, and every discussion we have on AAU TV is about how we can integrate education as a different part of the success of Africa's story. And today on this show, I have with me a very important guest to discuss the higher education space in Africa in the era of COVID-19, the case study of the Gambia. So don't go anywhere. Go for a short break. We'll come back. I'll let you know who this guest is and zoom right to the discussion. Don't go anywhere. You're welcome back to AAU Talks, the voice of higher education in Africa. My name is Agyemang Okyere Darko. Before we went for the break, we'll discuss the topic, which is the education space in Africa, a case study, the Gambia in the era of COVID-19. With me in the studio is a very distinguished guest. He's a qualified teacher, a politician, and also the Minister of Education in the Gambia. Have with me Honorable Badara Alieu Joof.
Thank you.
Sir, you're welcome to AAU Talks.
Thank you for having me.
Great. I'm so glad you're here with me. And I want to start by saying, what brings you to Ghana?
Well, we have a program with KNUST.
Great.
KNUST has been the chosen university for the mentorship of the new university that we are establishing called the USET, the University of Science, Engineering and Technology.
Great.
And we are here to see, assess the situation thus far, mm-hmm. and see how we can deepen the cooperation with KNUST.
Great.
That's why we are here. But also to see the Quality Assurance Agency in Ghana and to discuss collaboration in that area, how to enhance quality, relevance, and appropriateness in the Gambian education system. With the Ghana Quality Assurance Agency having the experience, the expertise, and the pedigree. So we think they have something to offer and we can learn something from Ghana.
Mm. Yeah. I trust it's been a very nice time so far in Ghana.
Yes, thus far the weather is okay. only in Kumasi yesterday it rained heavily, but right. It was after our program, so that was good.
That's nice. Yeah. Well, so I can just sense the passion you have for technology, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics in Africa. How well do you think this can really take us far and achieve the Africa we want?
Well, I think recently, there is a rude awakening for African universities and African leadership.
Yeah.
It is often said that when a tired society lifts its weary head mm-hmm. and looks for hope on the horizon, it fixes its gaze on the young people.
Great.
But if you look at the Europe to Africa migration, the most important thing that a person has is his life or her life.
Yeah.
When people, young people, who are the potential for tomorrow, who are the leaders for tomorrow, who would make the difference of today for tomorrow, risk their lives in the desert sands of the Sahara
yeah.
and get perished, some of them, or find themselves in a hostile country where they are enslaved by the Mediterranean shores, or still go through the treacherous waters of the Mediterranean and get drowned.
Yeah.
Or even when they make it to the shores of Europe, they are not mostly welcome.
Yeah.
They are behind barbed wires, quarantine, and those who escape without the relevant skills find themselves picking apples, oranges. That should prick the conscience of the African leadership. That should also prick the conscience of African intellectuals,
yeah.
particularly those who are in academia and are responsible for molding them, for giving them the wherewithal, the skills that they need for home to be sweet home. If you leave home to die in the desert, then home is sour home. And that's a wake-up call for African universities, for African institutions, for African educationalists. What is there that is missing?
Yeah.
What is the push factor?
Yeah.
how can we reverse the push factor into the pull factor? Mm-hmm. Bring those people back.
Yeah.
Equip them with the necessary skills, tools, and the resources that would make a difference in their life.
Mm.
They live a meaningful life. True. At the end of the day, everybody wants a meaningful life. Self-actualization. But it goes beyond the self. It should. It's the national self, the continental self. That is what is important. If we allow this push factor to go, we are mortgaging not only the lives of those students, but the lives of the African people and the African continent. And I think that will not be a good thing that we can live with as a legacy.
I think the African youth wishes to understand the strategic focus of the Gambian Higher Education Ministry. What has been the prime focus? I know STEM is part of them. What has been the focus? Where do you really want to move education in the Gambia? And how should it fit in?
Let me put it in a historical context.
All right.
In the 60s, 50s and the 60s, it was the fight for independence, political independence.
Okay.
And people were studying political science. And all. In the 70s and the 80s, it was the time for the ERPs and the PSD, Programs for Sustainable Development.
Mm-hmm.
And people were more into economics, you know. We are now in the digital age.
Yeah.
In the age that is driven by science, engineering, and technology.
Mm-hmm.
So we should respond to the demands and the dictates of the times.
Okay.
Or else we get marooned. Hence, in the Gambia, the policy shift is that we concentrate at least 65% of our policy focus is on the STEM, in the STEM area.
Mm.
And that's the way we are going, so that we are also not marooned and left behind.
Mm.
Yeah. Because that's the way society is going.
Yeah.
That's the way the world is going. Everything is e-something, e-education, e-health, you know, e-agriculture. It's a dot-com era. So we should produce the dot-com brains.
Exactly.
That would match the demands of the dot-com era to be able to make a quantum leap of progress in our development agenda.
I think the focus is ideal for the times we're in, but it all starts with how resourced our universities are, how resourced our universities in Gambia, and how capable are they to chart such a course.
I think resources are, you know, a challenge in my country.
Yeah.
Simply because we are not endowed with the A to Z of the development vitamins like oil, iron ore, bauxite or uranium or gold. But we have the human resources.
Okay.
And we cut our quota according to our size and we move on in a staircase fashion, seriatim, incrementally. But also we have partners that we can share with, you know, knowledge sharing, experience sharing, expertise sharing, so that those people, the lessons that they have gone through, you know, we can learn from those lessons in order not to make the mistakes of that, the past, and also the challenges that they encounter. We can rethink the way forward in terms of our pathway. So that we say, well, this is the way Ghana did it, or Nigeria did it, or Rwanda did it. You know, how can we adapt? There's no one size fit all, but we can also see our situation, domesticate it, index it, indigenize it, and make a difference, so that we can also be part of the crowd that is moving towards a better future, a la the influence of science, engineering, and technology.
Mm. I know 2 years ago, last year, was a very tough time with the COVID-19 pandemic just taking all over things. And, you know, higher education went on a halt in many parts of the world, but it took the prepared universities to take education right from traditional to more of digital platform. How was the case like with the University of Gambia or Gambian universities?
We were not an exception. You know, it was something that virtually caught almost the world, you know, unawares. You had even doubting Thomases that said, oh no, it didn't exist. But in reality, it did.
It did.
And we had to quickly also, you know, put our house in order. We discuss with the service providers in the country. We discuss with the Ministry of Finance at all levels, at the cabinet level, at the National Assembly level. Mm-hmm. You know, the Ministry of Finance was not prepared for that day because they did not budget for it, but they had to go for a supplementary appropriation. Yeah. We also, used the Google platform, which was interactive, which students could do their research, download lectures, and so on. Mm-hmm. And, the government paid for that. You know, of course, at a discounted rate with the service providers, because there is also some social corporate responsibility.
Yeah.
This cuts across tribes. It does not only hit higher education. It was hitting everybody. And we need to team up, come together, so that we can make a difference, address these challenges. And we're still on it. And when it was contained, we turned to the universities and said, you were not prepared for this. Now that you have gone through this life experience, mm-hmm. what can you do? What is the way forward in terms of, God forbid, having another challenge like this?
Yeah.
You know, so you start working on it, because that's the whole thing.
Yeah.
You know, if you have some rude awakening, you don't just, you know, if you weather the storm, you don't just sit lay back and say, no, it will never happen. No, never say it will not happen. To allow is to happen.
Yeah. Great. No, we keep thinking about the future of African higher education. What should the continent be? You know, the continent has been expected to be, in so many years to come, a continent full of vibrant young people, very rich human capital. And everybody has a say in it. Even the Gambia, you do. What do you want to see the youth of Gambia become in the next, the unforeseen future? What skills should they possess? And how fast should they take the economy of Gambia?
Well, I think, what the Gambian youth should become, and by continental translation, the African youth, would highly depend on the leadership that sets the tone politically and also resources and also the challenges of our development. These three variables, if you are able to end, getting the right leadership, that puts the people first, not themselves first. That it is... an enabling environment of governance, you know, for people, not for politicians, not for persons.
Yeah.
We go beyond the individual and look at the collective self, then we can make a difference. That the African leaders should put more resources in education. Education is at the front line of development. That is number one. Take the youth seriously. Look at programs that are, you know, that respond to the needs of the continent and the Gambia for that matter, and provide the resources, you know, rather than spending more money on arms, on, you know, cut the defense budget. You know, why should we fight with each other? It doesn't make sense, brother. It doesn't.
That's at all.
It doesn't. You spend almost 12-13% of your budget, you give education 1%, you wouldn't go. You know? Newly emerging economies, the Asian tigers
came. Yeah.
You know, it was, expenditure. They were in the front line of the Cold War, fine. But to stop at that kind of definition, I think, is reductionist. You know, there was the frugal tough-mindedness of the people and the foresight of the leaders to see beyond themselves.
Yeah.
Reason beyond their nose and put the people first, invested in them, provided them the skills. And you look at, hence, you're educating for the future. It's an uncertain future. You cannot be absolute about the future, but at least you can have some signposts depending on the prevailing times. And those signposts will tell you which way at least to follow for the time being. But you make it flexible and respond and be change-seeking as you go along in terms of your development agenda. Mm-hmm. Because it is the world is a global village.
Sure.
The Gambia cannot move in isolation. And Africans also should stop walking in silos.
Yeah.
Let us team up, you know, in all the fields, whether it's education, culture, economics, then we make a difference. Unity is strength. And we have a pool of minds that, you know, one of the finest minds, mm-hmm. the best, mm-hmm. the brightest in Africa.
Yeah.
You know, why are we still where we are?
Sure.
That's the question that African academics and African politicians should answer.
I think you mentioned that we can move in silos. We have the African Union, which is supposed to be like a unifying body for us all. So we'll talk more about the African Union and more into some other developmental systems that we're bringing on board. Don't go anywhere. Go for a short break. We'll come back with more discussions with Honorable Badara. Don't go anywhere.
Are you an institution or individual? Do you intend to organize a memorable event to be archived for future reference? Then look no further than AAU Studios, because it's your best bet. With our spacious studio and state-of-the-art media equipment such as 4K Panasonic video cameras, KinoFlow lights, assorted microphones, live streaming equipment, among others, you are sure to get the best of productions. Visit us at Trinity Avenue, East Legon, adjacent the National Accreditation Board, or contact the AAU Studios via the following email addresses: info@aau.org, aautv@aau.org, or ransford@aau.org. Alternatively, you can call us on +233 244 736280.
Welcome back to AAU Talks, the voice of higher education in Africa. My name is Agyemang Okyere Darko, and I'm joined here by Honorable Badara Alieu Joof, the Minister of Education in the Gambia. And we're discussing the education space in the Gambia in the era of COVID-19. And before we went for the break, we were mentioning the African Union as the unifying body. In the presence of the African Union and what they're doing, do you still think African countries are still moving in silos?
I think there is need and room for improvement, for deepening the collaboration and partnership, and for the AU to set, you know, a more robust agenda of collaboration and cooperation.
Great.
So that, I mean, yes, you can move at the country level, the regional level like ECOWAS, but also there must be a continental focus, and the African Union should take the lead role in terms of working, you know, in tandem with the Association of African Universities to forge a development agenda globally for the continent. But of course, there are individual, peculiarities which we can look at the country level. But globally, we should. And the global initiative should be the impetus that would propel the national initiative. So that at least there's, some harmony somewhere, you know, but also we are all supporting each other and moving in the same direction for the continent.
Great. I want to take you to a different level of developmental agendas, and this is the African Centers of Excellence, which with help of the World Bank have been able to set up 53 of them in Africa. What is your perspective of the ACE and its impact in helping Africa realize its great pillars in education?
Well, when you talk about a center of excellence, we define excellence in what? Is it just in rote learning, you know, in remembering issues, the old tradition of education, or is it a shift in perspective in terms of how our knowledge helps our development as peoples, as a country, and as a continent? And I think that's where the focus should be.
Okay.
That it's an applied as type of knowledge, not knowledge for knowledge's sake. You know, it must have a utilitarian value, you know, which would make a difference in the lives of the
people. Sure.
The biggest, development malaise in Africa is poverty.
Sure.
And also ignorance in terms of literacy levels
education.
And so on.
Sure.
Education. So I think if we focus on those two, if our knowledge can free us of the poverty trap, you know, so that we don't talk about, those fancy phrases like, alleviating poverty. No, we are not talking about alleviating poverty or reducing poverty. We are aiming at eradicating poverty. And we have everything on the continent and some in some countries, everything to eradicate poverty, you know. But to start, the first thing you need, the first enabling environment of poverty eradication is peace. Is peace. Conflict countries become fragile countries or failed countries. We have to sort that out amongst ourselves.
Yeah.
You know? But you look at the senseless wars in the continent. They don't minister to poverty elimination. No, we have to, AU has to set the standard, you know, put, make sure that we have peace in the continent, come together, fight poverty. That should be our number one enemy. This is where we put the guns, the ideological guns.
Somewhere last year, the AU had a campaign, the Silencing the Guns campaign.
Yes.
What is your view towards the campaign? Do you think it's successful?
I think it could be more effective. Mm. The providence of the future does not lie in the barrel of the AK-47 with the khaki boys. It lies in sound policies, programs, initiatives that are relevant to the development of the continent and to our countries and our people.
Great. I will now take you to the ACE project and its contribution. What has been its contribution, basically? You said sometimes the focuses of these projects should be much more to the base of it. Do you think we can make this better with the ACE project all over Africa?
Yes, I think so too. It's a good initiative. We needed a lot of improvement in the science, technologies, and engineering. And with the ACE, we are able to, at least start, you know, take the first step towards the achievement of that by, upgrading an institution like GTTI, mm-hmm. The Gambia Technical Training Institute, to a University of Applied Science and Engineering and Technology, the USET. And we are supposed to choose a center of excellence. And we looked around and we felt that Kwame Nkrumah has what it takes mm-hmm. to mentor the new fledging university in the Gambia.
Great.
And that's how we established the relationship with Kwame Nkrumah. Mm-hmm. Kwame Nkrumah, the program is designed in such a way that for a start, because we don't have, you know, the expertise,
sure.
Kwame Nkrumah will do the recruitment. They discuss with us the curriculum. We agreed on it. Mm-hmm. They will do the mentorship. They will do the certification and so on for a period of 4 years.
Great.
And that will allow us maybe to have progress at an appreciable level of development where we can have our own charter, you know. And we are starting initially, for a start, the disciplines, the Faculty of Mechanical Engineering, the Faculty of Civil Engineering, and the Faculty of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, you know. In time, we plan to add a few more disciplines like geometrics, pharmacology, and so on and so forth.
Great.
Yes.
I would want us to visit the SDG 5, which talks about equality for both males and females, equal rights for women, gender equality. And now you are really roping in STEM into your education system in Gambia. How well do you intend to create more room for gender equality, especially giving more room for women in STEM?
My philosophy or position might not be the universal thing, because sometimes if you go too universal, you miss your cardinal points. Equal access, yes, for everybody, male, female, but we cannot determine equal outcomes. Mm-hmm. And outcomes will determine the next level of progression. I'll give you a simple example. At the level of the secondary school, 2,000, 3,000, or 10,000 will write to the WAS. Mm-hmm. But maybe out of the 10,000, only 1,000 would have access to university because the admission criteria is selective. Mm-hmm. You know, it's an ironic variation of social Darwinism. You know, so you cannot. Tell the system that it's not gender sensitive. That's the way it is. Mm. You know, there's some element of selectivity in nature. So we give everybody equal access, but the outcomes is performance based. Mm. It's excellence based, as the nomenclature implies. Mm. It's merit based. It's merit driven, excellence driven. It's not just mass driven. Mm. No, then that would be garbage in, garbage out. If all the excellent ones are female, so be it. If they are all male, so be it. Mm-hmm.
But what about, are you not worried about, you know, female participation in STEM actually takes a low toll in the African continent. We don't find so much women excelling in the fields of engineering, science, and mathematics. And, you know, we have some affirmative actions that have been taken by some governments in Africa to ensure that women are given some quota. We just want to invite them onto the floor and develop people of that kind to match up the gap. Do you think it's not a good way?
Well, you can give them a quota in politics.
Okay.
Give them a quota in the development discourse, you know, dialogue. Make them, participate, you know. You don't even need a quota. Involve all of them in the discussions and the politics and all of everything else.
Yeah.
And even the setting of the, education or development agenda. That's fine. But when it comes to institutional participation, give them the access.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah.
But the output is performance based. How would can you justify the propriety of denying, let's say, 10 students who are A students because some B female students are there and you say affirmative action, give it to the B? You are compromising quality, you are compromising excellence, and in terms of social justice, that is not fair.
Yeah. I think that that's amazing one there from you on that fact. So let's take it from the SDG goal number 8, that's creating more economic growth and more viable jobs in the economy. How would you want to see the Gambia and even in Africa? What kind of jobs do you really want to create in your economy? For now, that STEM is now on the progress, on the rise. What should be the kind of jobs we should be seeing in the Gambia?
Well, I think, at the technician level, the jobs that are the growth drivers, you know, where you have to build the skills, you know, of the young people so that, you know, you create a three-track employability possibility.
Yeah.
One is self-employment or being employed by the public sector or by the private sector. And this is where technical and vocational education is important.
Sure.
And also changing the perspective of technical and vocational education. I mean, in time past, if you are in those areas, you are seen as an academic failure.
Yeah,
even it affects your private life because if a professor from Legon or a first graduate degree from Legon stands and you know you're just an automotive technician and you want to marry this girl, on balance of probability, the girl will go for the chair from Legon.
Yes,
because of the gainful life, you know, that is associated with these the degrees and so on.
Yeah.
And it's not always like that. The man who has his corner shop, his garage, with the relevant skills, could earn more than me. Because if I take my car there, he would charge me.
Yeah.
And most probably, if he knows that I'm a minister, he would charge the minister, not the individual. So his take-home pay is better. I think we need to change the perception of technical and vocational education in Africa. Make more people get involved in this, whether it's in fisheries, whether it's in the trade, or in the mechanical areas or technical areas, electrical technicians, refrigeration, and even the media and so on. We need to promote that. You know, these are gainful jobs and they are easy paying. They don't wait for, they are not monthly paid jobs.
Yeah.
This is the here and now. You know, you may have 2-3 cars waiting for you. You may have 2-5 refrigerators waiting for you to repair. You do that in a day, your take-home pay would be more than the president, perhaps, you know, within the month. The market needs it. That's the job market. Let the market determine. It should be market-driven, not supply-driven. It's demand-driven.
Yeah.
And the development demands of the country should dictate the education agenda that would respond to that demand, you know, and make a difference in the life of the people.
Great.
That's the way I see the way, forward for us. That's
great.
The way we should be thinking as policymakers, as politicians, and program technician implementation.
Great.
You know, the political will, the technical will, to drive that kind of skills agenda.
Great. I'm so inspired by your passion for growing the continent of education, even with regards to TVET, because I'm also passionate about TVET, and I really envy how things are running in the Gambia right now. With regards to TVET, I wish that we give more emphasis to TVET systems for them to grow more professionally and have more people moving to TVET willingly, not because they just couldn't get a higher education certificate, so they now use TVET as their second option. So thank you so much, Honorable Badara, for your time. I really want to hear from you. Do you have any last words for the African youth? Because we want to hear from our leaders, inspire an African youth out there. Tell them what they need to do right now.
I think at the level of the AU, it should be a binding obligation, you know, for African countries to spend, to create a develop a center of excellence development fund.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah.
We cannot depend on the World Bank forever. It won't last.
Yeah.
You know, there's a limit to it. But if we create our own fund and support the 53 centers, deepen it, broaden it, and then give it a continental translation, I think we'll go somewhere.
Great.
Cut the the defense budget, condition African countries, and have some element of accountability and sanctioning, you know, that you must spend so much, you know, which could be controlled by the Association of African Universities or on the mandate of the AU to say this is the fund that we are creating. Everybody subscribes to it. We can prorate it depending on, of course, you know, the size of our economies.
Yeah.
And then, you know, we work on these centers of excellence. You know, it's an ongoing thing. Development is not like, it's a process. It's a process.
Yeah.
It's always on, ad infinitum, you know?
Sure.
Because, we started since the days of the Homo Faber, you know, when man was just, you know, roaming the wild up to today, you know, so that people improve. You look at Dubai in the 60s, in the 50s, during the days of, Sheikh Yamani in Saudi Arabia and so on. It was a desert.
Yeah.
And the means of transportation, you know, was just camel.
Sure.
But the development curve between the camel and the Lexus and the 3Bs, the Bentley and the BMs and the Benzes, is very short.
Yeah.
Today, everybody is talking about Dubai.
Yeah.
You know, you look at Rwanda, you know, they've forgotten, not forgotten about the genocide, but it did not bog them down.
Yes.
They made a difference.
More stronger.
Yeah. And the same thing. Why can't we not make it?
Yeah.
We can, as Obama said, but we should be able to say we did. With history.
Great.
You know, I mean, we owe it to the young people. It's a moral obligation.
Mm-hmm.
Trudeau Parker, you know, 18th century theologian, you know, Martin Luther quoted a lot, said, the moral arc of the universe is long, but it ultimately bends towards justice.
Whoa.
And when it bends towards justice, and we are subpoenaed to make a presence for that judgment for the young people, I hope we will not be found guilty.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Honorable Badara Alieu Joof, for your very passionate and soothing words to the African youth out there. I think all hope is not lost, but we should believe that our leaders today owe us an obligation, and we also owe posterity an obligation to ensure a sustainable, developed economy in Africa. Thank you so much for your time with us on AAU Talks. I'm also glad you had time to enjoy the show and all the great insights and important facts that were shared to us by Honorable Badara Alieu Joof. And keep watching AAU TV, the voice of higher education in Africa. And we are poised each day to inform, to transform. My name is Agyemang Okyere Darko, and catch you next time on AAU Talks. Have a nice day and bye.